Hello, I'm Dr. Mikey Mewborn, and this is Systematic Theology 2. Today we're looking at the topic, the extent of the atonement. Now we've already looked at the nature of the atonement, we've defined the atonement, and we've looked at theories that are inadequate for the atonement. But what we're going to do today is we're going to talk about two different concepts mainly. We're going to talk about limited atonement, that Jesus Christ died on the cross for a specific group of people, or we'd say a particular group of people, and unlimited atonement, the idea that Jesus Christ died on the cross for all peoples, and not just all peoples, but anyone who would believe. And so there's a different focus there that we're going to look at, and so we're going to talk about those things today. It's good to be with you. Let's begin our study. Hello and welcome to Systematic Theology 2. Today we're looking at the extent of the atonement. It's good to be with you. Let's begin our study. I want to start by looking at this slide. It's Jesus with several children. And one of the focuses of this slide is Jesus loves all the children of the world. We sing songs about that, but we also teach this often in our theology. We express that Jesus loves the world. God so loved the world. We hear those scriptures and they become a part of us. And so what we're going to look at today is the idea that Jesus is the Savior of all peoples. I want to begin by looking at Galatians 3, 27 through 29. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is no male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to promise. So when we look at this passage right in the middle, verse 28, we're seeing that Jews, Greeks, slaves, free, male, and female, they're all a part of the body of Christ because Jesus is the Savior of all peoples. In Romans 1:16, the Apostle Paul wrote, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." Now the idea there is that the Apostle Paul is bringing the gospel to all these peoples, and he is saying it's not just for the Jew, it's also for the Greek. And throughout the book of Romans, we also see this in Ephesians and Galatians, that the gospel has gone first to the Jew, and now it is going to the Gentiles, and they are being saved. And so it's not prejudice against one of those groups, and it's only not only focusing on one group. It's actually saying the gospel is open to both. So what we're going to look at is this idea of Jesus being the Savior of all peoples. Now, as we go, we're going to come into a subject of Calvinism and Arminianism. And here's why. In the whole line of thinking here, there is a teaching that we can look at and try to better understand what is the Bible saying about the atonement. And when we look at the ideas of Calvinism versus Arminianism, and we might look at that from the TULIP standpoint, total depravity, unconditional election, limited atonement, irresistible grace, perseverance of the saints, we're going to come at the middle part, the L, which is limited atonement versus atonement for all. Now, this has been a divisive type of subject for years. Who did Jesus Christ die on the cross for? Or his actions on the cross, who did that bring salvation to? So what we're going to say, what we're going to look at today is the idea, is it for all peoples or is it for a specific group of peoples? Is it particular or is it general? Is it indefinite or is it definite? It's the idea here that there is a difference between these two understandings. And so I want us to think about that as we get into this lesson, because regardless where you might fall in this belief system, it's important to know what the Bible says. And as you read the scripture, it's going to help you start to define or better articulate what your stance is in this area. All right, so let's go ahead and jump into that. We'll start by Romans chapter 5, verse 11. "More than that, we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation." Romans chapter 5 is very much about God demonstrating his love for us in this, while we are still sinners, Christ died for us. And it's talking about Christ dying for the ungodly. Now, the difference is that those in Adam will remain in sin and death, and they will face the consequences or the wages of sin. But those who believe in Christ, they will be given the gift of eternal life. Romans 5:18 kind of clarifies that for us. Therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, so one act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all men. So the teaching there is the differences between who you are in. If you're in Adam, you receive the condemnation. If you're in Christ, you receive justification and life. So who are you in? And so that's the difference. Now, when we're talking about limited versus unlimited, it's this idea of who is that person or who are these people that we're talking about. And reconciliation, and that, under that heading, we see a passage like this, 2 Corinthians 5:18 through 20. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. So here's the call to be reconciled to God. And so we see in verse 19, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself. The idea that God is bringing really the ungodly, the ones who are far off, they're being brought near to God through the work of Jesus Christ. You see this in Ephesians chapter 2 as well. And so bring them together, not counting their trespasses against them. That's the idea, the message of reconciliation. And then he talks about imploring people on behalf of Christ to be reconciled to God. And so this is kind of another way of looking at that. Now, in this whole line of thinking between limited and unlimited, I want to look at some quotes that help us to see what these people believed. So the first one is from Erwin Lutzer about limited atonement. He said, "If my friend paid my debt, justice requires that I be free. The analogy is clear. If Christ's sacrifice was for all men, then either all men will be saved or God will be unfairly demanding from sinners what has already been paid. If Christ died for people, who will be in hell? His justice is in jeopardy. How could a righteous God demand a double payment for the same debt?" And so that comes from the Reformed spirit and more of the doctrines Reformed thinking. And so that's Erwin Lutzer there. And then also we see from Dr. James White. By the way, Dr. James White is probably one of the most articulate people when it comes to expressing and explaining Calvinism and the doctrines of salvation, the doctrines of grace as seen from a Calvinistic or Reformed viewpoint. He said this, "In its simplest terms, the Reformed belief is this: Christ's death saves sinners. It does not make the salvation of sinners a mere possibility. It does not provide a theoretical atonement. Christ's death saves every single person that it was intended to save." And then we continue on to R.C. Sproul. He said this, limited atonement. "Some people react against the doctrine of limited atonement because it appears to take away from the greatness of the work of Christ. In reality, it's the Arminian position that diminishes and devalues the full impact and power of the atonement. The point Calvinists stress is that Christ accomplished what he set out to accomplish, the job the Father had designed for him to do. God's sovereign will is not at the whim and mercy of our person and individual response to it." All right, so that's his thinking there for the limited atonement. And then we see here with Charles Spurgeon, he wrote this, "I would rather believe a limited atonement that is efficacious for all men for whom it was intended than a universal atonement that is not efficacious for anybody except the will of men be added to it." And so all of these people are expressing the thought of limited atonement. They believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for a specific group of people that he has chosen, and we would save him before the foundation of the world as we know it, that they were selected out and Christ died for them. Okay? And so that's the idea of limited atonement. Now, you say, where do they get that idea, right? Well, here's some passages of scripture that helps you see where they're coming from. John 10:11. Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep." You could actually say, for his sheep. Ephesians 5:25, Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Who did he give himself up for? For the church, as you would read that. Revelation 5:9, the worshipers in heaven sing to Jesus, worthy are you, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. So there's people that God is saving out of every tribe, language, and people. It's not saying it's for all people. It's saying out of each of those. And then we continue on with Mark 10:45. In support of limited atonement, the Son of Man came to give his life as a ransom for many. So not all, but a ransom for many. And then John 11:52, Jesus died to gather into one the children of God who were scattered abroad. And then Acts 20:28, pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to care for the church of God, which he obtained with his own blood. Now, this is an important verse for us to look at because he's saying there's a specific group of people which he obtained with his own blood and talking about those of whom were saved. All right. Now, as we continue on, we'll look at some verses for unlimited atonement. 1 John 2:1-2, my little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. 1 John 4:14, and we have seen and testified that the Father has sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. These two verses right here speak of he is the propitiation for our sins, and this is, and not for our sins only, but also for the sins of the whole world. And so what is the world talking about there? Is it referring to lost people? Is it referring to saved people? If we were to talk about the elect, and so that would be a position there. And then, of course, the Savior of the world played out in 1 John chapter 4, talking about who are these people? Are they lost, ungodly, sinful, unholy, whoever they are, right? Is it that who we're talking about? The evil world, and those are the people that Jesus is the Savior of, or is it for the elect? And so those are some passages that speak of the unlimited atonement. 2 Peter 2:1, but false prophets also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. And many will follow their sensuality, and because of them, the way of the truth will be blasphemed, and in their greed they will exploit you with false words. Their condemnation from long ago is not idle, and their destruction is not asleep. I want you to see in this middle part, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. So these are the people that Peter is talking about here are false prophets, but the Bible says the master who bought them. And we know through our understanding of the atonement is a reference to the ransom has been paid. Jesus said, it is finished, it is paid, the debt is paid. And so there's the idea of that's being taught. Then also in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9, the Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. And then another passage similar to that would be for the Jews. It says in Matthew 23:37, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it, how often would I have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing. It's speaking there of the desire of the Lord in these two verses. And kind of the idea is that God is not wishing that people would perish in 2 Peter, but they would come to repentance. And then he says in Matthew 23, how often I would have gathered you as children, but you're not coming. And we know that's for the Jews, but they were going against God, and that's rejecting God, and that's resisting him. All right. And then in 1 Timothy 2:1-6, another passage for unlimited atonement, I urge then, first of all, that petitions, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all those in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. This is good and pleases God our Savior, who wants all people to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and mankind, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all people. This has now been witnessed to at the proper time. Being made for all people, verse 4, who wants all people to be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. And then verse 6, who gave himself as a ransom for all people. And so there you see some more support verses that people who believe in unlimited atonement, that's what they're giving forth. And then another passage I just think is so important for us, 1 Timothy 4:10, for to this end we toil and strive because we have our hopes set on the living God, who is the Savior of all people, especially of those who believe. And so this is another support for unlimited atonement, but really the fact that Jesus is the Savior of all people, and it's important to see that. And we could say Jesus is the Savior of the world. Now, there may be some different definitions of how people would define the world, or who are these specific people, and are these just the elect, or are they people of all of all backgrounds, and Jews, Gentiles, slaves, free, male, female, anyone that's ever lived, anybody like that. Who are these people? Well, that's up for definition, right? And that's up in our explanations of how we look at these things. But when we're thinking of the extent of the atonement, it's important for us to know what are the major beliefs out there. Limited and unlimited atonement are two of the things that have been argued over for many years. And so it's important for us to know what these different doctrines are. And so I wanted to share those with you today. It's good to be with you. This has been The Extent of the Atonement. God bless you, and hope you have a great rest of the day. Bye-bye. All right, that concludes our study today about the extent of the atonement. This is a wonderful topic for us because all of us, as we've talked about before, are theologians, and we're trying to better understand and articulate our beliefs. And this lesson is helpful for you to be able to do that. So whether you believe in more of a limited atonement focus or you believe in unlimited atonement, well, that's for you to decide, absolutely. So as we're walking through this, this lesson will help you know what that's all about. All right, it's good to be with you. God bless you, and we'll talk to you soon. Bye-bye.